two or more are gathered in his name, he is there. For all who come, who run to him in faith, he is there. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power, power in his name. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power, power in his name. No fear, no lie can stand against us now. He is here. Whoa, the word has come to silence every doubt. He is here. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power, power in his name. There is power in the name of Jesus.
I want to be at his feet. I want to be at the cross, and I want And I just want to worship him this morning for saving me. Because if he's never done anything for me, he has saved me. He's done so much more, but he has saved me. He has set me free. I can spend eternity with him. Hallelujah. And I want to worship him for that. Hallelujah. God, you are good and you are worth glorifying. We praise you this morning as one body. We praise you. We honor you. We glorify you. We thank you, Jesus. We love you.
Overcome.
This morning that it is done.
Yes.
It is done.
Yes. Amen.
Jesus has already overcome the grave. And all you have to do is let him know, Jesus, I believe that you came and that you died for me and that it is done, that you've overcome the grave. I believe that you saved me. I believe that I am free. Hallelujah. I believe that I am free. I believe in you, Jesus. I believe you're my Savior. I believe you're my deliverer. I believe you are my freedom. I believe in you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I believe you are the Messiah. I believe you are the only one. The only one worth praising. The only one worth worshiping. The only one worth glorifying. I believe, and I thank you for loving me. He loves you right where you are, no matter what you've gone through, no matter what you did 10 years ago or 10 minutes ago, he loves you. He is good, and his love is good, and it's true, and it's pure. It is the purest love. Thank you for loving me right where I am, God. Hallelujah. He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. Humbled himself and he carried the cross. A love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all. So amazing, a love so amazing, yeah. Jesus Messiah, I just want you to take a moment, close your eyes, lift up your hands in worship. If you've never even done it before, just do it. Lift up your hands and let Him pour into you as you pour out your praise. And I want us all to sing this together, all out loud. Just sing it with us. Jesus Messiah. Ready? Jesus Messiah, name above all names, yes you are, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin. The final say. You are the Lord of all. I put my life in your hands. God, I ask for this country to be in your hands. I ask for this world to be in your hands, God. We're in your hands, Jesus. It's all up to you. What you say goes. We give it all up to you, God. We can't do anything but give it to you. And trust you with it, God. And that's the best thing to do. We trust you with it, God. We lift you up and we honor you. You are Jesus, the greatest name, the name above all names. You are Jesus Messiah, our Savior, our Deliverer, our Friend. We believe in you, King Jesus. You are our King, and we believe in you, Jesus. Can we sing it, Jesus Messiah, one more time? Lord of all, hallelujah. All together now, Jesus Messiah. Jesus Messiah, loud and clear. Name above all names, yes you are. Your blessed Redeemer, that means he's with us, Emmanuel.
The rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven. Oh, Jesus, Messiah, Lord of all.
Say that with me, Lord of all. Lord of all, you are Lord of all. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, everybody say it. He's Lord of all. Everything will allow him to be Lord over. He's Lord. Am I right? Can you turn to somebody and tell them the Lord is right here, right now. So whatever you need, don't wait. Don't put it off. He's here. Can we give this praise team a great appreciation this morning? Love you so much. What a blessing you are. And also, Dr. John on the keyboard, what a blessing you are. We appreciate you so very much. Come on, tell somebody, everything's going to be all right. Even that, everything's going to be all right. You may be seated if you like this morning. Is anybody blessed this morning? Let me ask you again. Anybody really blessed this morning? How many of you remember a time when you were not blessed? That'll cause you to rejoice even greater. We're thankful today. So many good things going on, and it's a busy season. The Lord has been speaking to my heart. I want to share some things in a few moments about where we are. Most of you know that at the beginning of the year, God gave us guidance of what was getting ready to happen, and it's happening. And I think we realize that right now we're having to go through a second phase of this pandemic, whatever you want to call it, whatever's really going on. But I want you to understand, we're in the middle of a change. Everybody say, we're in the middle of a change. And this is a good time for God to show up. So what do you mean? Well, he's already here, but let's let him show off. Okay, man. Do you think God can take care of my situation? Brother John and I were talking for the service. You know how big God's hands are? If he can hold the world in the palm of his hand, I think he can fix your little mess and my little problem. Am I right? Everybody say, he's right here, right now. And so we're in the business of doing a lot of things. Spirit of Truth, we do a lot of things. We're known for our love, and that's because you're such loving people. Should have got a lot more amens on that one. And how many know sometimes love has to bring correction, but it's still love. Love has to bring direction, but it's still love. Love can correct you while you smile. Amen. How many know God doesn't always weep over the fact that he's got to straighten us out? He knows he's doing it for his glory and our benefit. So I'm going to ask, if you will, to begin to prepare your heart. But we want to do something very, very special. We've never done this before ever, and we'll never do it again. We're going to give away a baby. We're going to give it back to, we're not going to auction it off. We're going to give it back to the Lord. Amen. How many of the Lord gives, and now we're going to let him have the baby again? Because I have learned with three grown children that we can't always do it. We can't always make it right. We can't always know what to do exactly right. But how the Spirit can guide you in that. We're very, very blessed. So if we can, would you come on up for just a moment, prepare the baby. And while they're handling and swapping it back and forth, I want to read a scripture, and I want you to listen closely. When Jesus was born, in Luke 2, we'll go to verse 22, when the days of marriage purification, according to the law of Moses, were accomplished, they brought Jesus to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. That's what we're doing today. We're officially presenting Adeline to the Lord. We're presenting back to the Lord that gave her. Now, the Bible said in verse 25, behold, there was a man in Jerusalem. His name was Simeon. The same man was just, devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. It was revealed to him by the Holy Ghost that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. He came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him as the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms, and he blessed God, and he said, Lord, now let thy servant depart in peace according to your word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation. Can you imagine what it must have been to be the one that got to hold and see the Savior, knowing who he was? Which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles, the glory of thy people Israel. Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him, and even though they knew it, they were shocked at the revelation. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, behold, this child is set for a fall and rising again of many in Israel, for a sign which will be spoken against, for yes, a sword is going to pierce through your own soul also, so that the thoughts of many can be revealed. What Simeon was saying that day is, Mary, you're the mother that brought him. And your heart is going to break when men crucify him and reject him. But that is going to happen so that who he really is and what he came to do will be revealed. Now, I want you to understand, we're not declaring that this beautiful, precious baby is Jesus. But we are declaring that we are presenting her back to the Father today. And I want you to listen very closely. I believe with all of my heart and all of our prayers and all of our agreement, we believe that she is also going to bring great glory to the kingdom of God. I believe that the God that they serve is going to be honored. There's going to be much praise and appreciation for the kingdom. Now, the reason I say that is because so many times in life, we have to realize that when a child is born, we have to realize that a blessing is coming. We sometimes don't realize why God gave this child at this time. Come on over, if you will, for just a moment. Don't you love them so very much? Amen. Daniel and Beth and Adeline. They're very precious in our sight. I'm not going to tell you how long I've known Mama. Amen. Or Daddy. But he's tougher than I am, so I'm going to say nice things today. Love him so much. I know all of you do. But I want you to take just a moment, if you will. We're going to ask that all the family, if I had all the family come up, we couldn't see anybody. But they're related to so many, not only natural bloodline, but also spiritually. I believe today that what God is doing in this little precious life. Now, see, I'm her favorite uncle. Just thought I'd drop that in. And there's something about a child that's so mysterious because we don't know what lies in store. Beth, this child has brought healing to you. Daniel, this child has brought healing. Sometimes we don't realize that we think it's a baby that God has given us. See, the enemy didn't want that, but God did. God gave this child to them. And I believe with all my heart, this child is going to rise up and glorify the Father. I believe this child, and I don't know about you, but I look around and I see the grandparents and I see the gifts and the talent and the music and the songwriting and the abilities. So, I mean, I'm sorry, but it's just in line. Am I right? And I would like for her to be the best singer and musician and songwriter of all of them. Amen. She has no clue what I'm saying, but she's in total agreement with the preacher today. I'm going to ask you to realize this again. When we have the privilege of holding a child or loving a child, we have a privilege of leading a child. Children so many times become what would they see us do. I'm going to say as a pastor, I want to live right so she has an example to follow. As family, I want all of us to live right so she has more examples to follow. As the body of Christ, I want us to act right in front of her, guide her, love her, and strengthen her so she has a whole lot more people to recognize that the Christ lives on the inside. Somebody said, I thought you weren't dedicating Jesus. I'm not, but she is a part of his body. She is a part of the family of God as his family is, and we're going to watch God's commanded blessing upon her. I want us to stand together. I know this is a little different, but I want you to stand in agreement. Today we're going to ask a commanded blessing upon the baby. Would you help me a moment? You'll be in my mic stand. Father, as Simeon reached up and grabbed the baby Jesus, they said, mine eyes have seen the consolation of Israel, the Savior. I thank you, Father, because you allowed him to see his answer and his victory. I thank you today because our eyes are beholding a child that's going to grow up and be a tremendous blessing, not only to mom and daddy and grandparents and friends, but to the world. God, there's something special about Adeline, and I ask that people begin to very quickly recognize your hand is upon her life. Let us do everything in our power to bless and honor her. Father, right now we realize that sometimes we won't know what to say or we won't know what to do. But you're going to let your sweet Holy Spirit guide us and direct us. So we ask you to bless her life. Give her health, long days, wisdom, peace, joy, prosperity. Bless everything this little life desires and craves to be of the glory in the kingdom of God. I thank you, Father, because you have given us this gift. Today, as Beth and Daniel agree that we're going to give her back to you, Father, for your will, for your glory. We'll enjoy her, Father. We'll eat meals together and we'll laugh and play together. We'll do all those natural things. But beginning today, I want us to begin to recognize that you brought her into the world for such a time as this. And you're going to let her rip off my glasses and embarrass me real good right in the middle of dedication. Jesus, I'm thankful. And I praise you. I want the body to point your hand this way and say, I command blessings upon her life. Peace, joy, love, happiness, every good and perfect gift. Magnify her gifts. Let great talent flow. A special anointing. In Jesus' name. Everybody in agreement, say amen. Now wait a minute. I don't know exactly the direction, but from her lineage, and she is in a long line of lineage of blessing, she could become a missionary. Amen. And y'all wouldn't see her for a while. She could be a songwriter and it would take her places. Nobody else can go. She could be a singer and God would do greater things. How many of you want nothing but the very best for her life? If you do, I want you to point your hand again and say, I release all the love that I have for her, to her. Guide her and guard her. Use her greatly. In Jesus' name. That'd be okay. Give us a scripture. Come on, give her a nice hand. Don't you love her? She's so precious. You're blessed. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated if you like this morning. Wow. You know, so many times people come to a place in life where they realize that blood is thicker than water, but spiritual connections are stronger than blood. Many in this house are much closer than some of my blood. Amen. That's what's called the family of God. That's what God is being to bring forth to every one of us. I'm thankful for her very, very much, and I realize that she won't be a church baby very long. Amen. How many realize she will grow up and she'll fulfill the calling and the gifting that God's laid upon her heart? I want to say a word, and I'm going to ask you to really let this indelibly be placed in your spirit. I want you to tattoo this on your soul, if you will, because this is where we are. This word has been what God has guided my life. During this last many days, he's been showing me, not only are we in the middle of this pandemic, not only are we ready now for things, look at me, we have no clue what laws are going to be placed on us. We don't have any clue what restrictions are going to be placed. How many know we're in the middle of this thing? We're kind of in a lull now. People are starting today. Some of my friends went started going back to church. They were allowed to go back to church. Some are going to do it later. Some are fearing to even start because they know that they're already planning the second wave. And how many know we don't know what the future is? But see, here's the beautiful thing about it. No matter what, God is in the midst. Let's say this word. We all know it. So let's just say it. It's in English today. Middle. Say, God is in the middle of my circumstance. God is in the middle. If I allow him, he'll be in the middle of every situation, every sickness, every threat. And if I allow him, he'll take over. Anybody tired of trying to live your own life? You like to let the Lord live it through you and have his will and have his way. Can somebody say, everything is going to be all right? Come on, say it. Everything is going to be all right. We did a study not long ago about when Jesus told the disciples, get in the boat, I'm going to take you to the other shore, and when you get out in the middle of the water, I'm going to send a storm. Well, he didn't tell them because that would scare them to death, but he walked on the water. Everybody say, walked on the water. And Peter looked at him, and he thought it was a ghost, and he said, Lord, is that you out there? If it's you, I want to come walk on the water. And the Lord said, come on, Pete, walk on the water with me. Not this Peter, it's the other one. And so what you have to understand is, when he got back in the boat, God proved himself as being one that could take care of the water. Another time, he told them, we're going to go to the other side. We are going to go to the other side. Some of you right now, the Lord has told you, you're going to do something, and the devil's trying to bring a storm and stop it. You're going to the other side. God is going to finish what he said he's, Lord, God is going to finish what he said he's going to do. So the Bible says, since Jesus knew that he was going to get there, he went to the back of the boat and fell asleep, and the storm came. Do you think he was shocked that the storm came? Or do you think he allowed the storm to come so he could teach his kids something in the storm. I've learned more in trouble than I've learned in easy times. I've grown up more in tough times than easy times. Am I right? So the Bible said the boat's full of water and they're trying to bail it out. And finally they look at Jesus with accusation and say, I don't even think you care that we're going to perish. Can you imagine God perishing in water? But see, in the storm, listen close, in the storm, in the middle of the storm, is where you tend to forget you've got the Lord with you. Well, the doctor said, wait, don't forget that God is with you and he's still healer. Well, my children in trouble, God is still with you. Well, I'm going through a great change. I know it, but God is still with you. How many of you know if he's with you, he's not just with you when the storm is over, he's with you in the midst of the storm. Lord, I love this because he is never going to leave you. He is never going to forsake you. When I was a child, some of the great theologians used to say, I pray to the God way up there in the seventh heaven. Well, that's your God. My God is right here, right now, and I don't have to wait till he comes on Sunday because he never leaves me, never forsakes me. He said, lo, I will be with you Sunday afternoon. When you're watching Christian TV, no, I will be with you all, never leave you, be with you always. How many know we need to recognize a very present God, constant God? Say it, he's always God. And if he's your God, he's with you all the time. So he doesn't have to show up in the storm, he never leaves. He doesn't have to get awake in your boat because he's always in your boat, alive and in control. Would somebody say, he likes to sit in the middle of the boat? Amen. Anybody have to remember back when we used to cry, oh God, come, please, Lord, don't you know where I am? Don't you know what I'm going through? It's like the Lord said, no, I didn't notice you're going through problems. Look at me. He knows more about the details of your life than you do. And he cares about the outcome more than you do. The outcome is not just to bail you out, it's to give him some glory and some honor. That's why he's allowing you to go through the storm and bring glory to his name. Can I get just one amen right there? Now, let's look at the scripture for just a moment. I won't have you go to a lot of places for time restraints, but how many of you know when God was getting ready to destroy the earth the first time with a flood, he was in the middle of a creative activity. He said, Noah, build an ark. And it took him a long time to build it, but the Lord allowed him to build an ark. Everybody say, when the ark was finished, God was way out there in the universe somewhere. No, he began to call the animals in. Two by two and by sevens. He began to bring them all in and they found their place. And he was in the plan of saving man's life. He was right there in the middle of the boat. Do you believe that? It's kind of funny that we don't recognize sometimes that when Jesus went over to his friend's area, a man named Lazarus that had died a few days ago, they had sent a note and they said, Jesus, the one you love, is sick. And the Lord delayed deliberately so that Lazarus could get really dead, so nobody could deny that he was really dead. So when he came to the tomb, he stood right there at the middle of the entrance. Everybody said, at the middle of the entrance of the tomb. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. Am I right? And Lazarus came forth, wrapped up in grave clothes, and the Lord said, whoever wrapped him up needs to unwrap him because he's not dead. I am in the midst of your situation. Let me say something. I was a day's journey away when he died, but I still was in the middle of the story. I already had it planned how I was going to get him up before he went down. I don't know if you know this or not, but God knows what you're going through, every detail of it, and he's with you in every situation. He's in the middle of every circumstance if you allow it, and if you get this today, you'll have never a reason to worry about anything else ever. Because if the Lord is right here, I don't think you have anything to worry about. Oh, the devil, don't better talk about that defeated liar. I don't want to even hear about him anymore. My Lord conquered him, death, hell, and the grave at one time by the power of the cross. How many of you realize that Jesus is our victory giver? There's sometimes we want to really put it off, but let's not do that. I want the Lord to be proud. I don't know about you, but I need him right now. I need him to keep on giving me peace when the news media talks junk. I need him to give me peace when they make me put on the mask so I can go in and eat my food. Amen. I learned a weird thing about this pandemic. I had to put on a mask to go in the restaurant in Gahanna just till I got in the lobby and then I could take it off. So it's not the restaurant that's a problem. It's the lobbies that are killing you. Don't write that down. Well, as soon as I get in the door, I can take it off. Why did I put it on? Anybody didn't know I was this smart? I mean, let's leave it on at least till I get to sit down. Then I can blow contagion on somebody taking my order with my mask off. How many of you understand? Don't get mad. Don't get all upset about all that stuff. Just comply when you feel it. Do what you feel. Do what you know you need to do. But how many of you know, don't you dare fear. The enemy has no weapon to form against you that can prosper. He already told us before it happened. He already told us before it started. He already told us that he is going to put us in a Goshen of safety. Oh, preacher, that was a good message. It wasn't a message, it was a word. Anybody want to be safe? Anybody want to get past memorization and walk in the reality? I don't know about you, but I kind of got a feeling everything's going to be all right. Somebody ought to write a song. Say it. I'm in the secret place of the Most High. Come on. He that abides under the secret place of the Most High will dwell, will stay there under the shadow of the Almighty. If my Father that loves me is right here, right now, he's not just my Savior. He's my healer. He's my protector. He's my guide. He's my joy giver. He's all that in one person, and he with me right now. Anybody ever feel like you're about to explode? That's because that big one on the inside swells up a little bit. Does anybody really have a big God on the inside? And you still feel small? The problem that we have, and you know it's true, we forget who's in the middle of our circumstance. Do we? Who's in the middle of your thoughts right now? Just questions. You don't have to answer out loud. When they took Jesus to the cross, they drove spikes in his hands and his feet, and they dropped him in a hole and disjointed. Every joint was disjointed, and his bones were ripped apart. That's scripture. That's history. And he's still hanging for his life and for my life. But isn't it amazing that he was the cross in the middle? He's right there in the middle. One side, death, hell, and the grave. The other side is resurrection, salvation. One man said, if you really are this Christ, you could get us off this cross. And he rebuked his Savior. The other guy said, God, you don't understand. He didn't do anything. We deserve this. He doesn't do anything. And as he's dying, the thief looked over at Jesus and he said, hey, guy in the middle cross, I'm paraphrasing. I need you in the middle of my circumstance. I've been a sinner and I got myself in trouble. Now I'm dying for it. I want you to remember me when you come in your kingdom. It's a weird salvation prayer, isn't it? Remember me. You know, the Lord doesn't just remember you once. He remembers you all the time. And the Lord said, not only will I remember you, but since I'm right here in the middle of your circumstance and your death and your sin, I'm going to become your antidote for sin. I'm going to be your sin sacrifice. And not only that, before the night has come, you and I are going to be shouting in paradise. Because you're over there on the far left cross, and I'm right here in the middle. Did anybody get that? How could he save? Because he was in the middle of the situation. Oh, brother, I never thought life would become this way. I never thought my family would be going through what I'm going through. Is the Lord with you in the middle of your circumstance? If he is, you have nothing at all to fear. That's not preacher talk. That's reality. Does anybody feel the Lord right here, right now? Was, oh, yeah, I got saved when I was a kid. Well, then you ought to stay saved. Well, I believe. No, if you believe, then you keep his commandments. If you love him with all your heart, mind, soul, and spirit, then you'll obey. You take on the Jesus way. Someone said, well, I fell down. Then you need to get full of the Holy Ghost. And if you do that, then he'll help you do what you can't do. You know, people have asked me for years, how do I keep myself from falling back in old sins? I don't have the power to control myself. I don't have self-control. Well, the Bible said there's some fruit and gift of the Spirit called self-control. How many of we need self-control? It eliminates selfishness too. Kathy made a profound statement of bodybuilding. She said, there's two things happening in the church. It's devastating. It's called selfishness and lying. Laziness. I like that one too, even better. Anybody know some Christians who used to be on fire, but not so much anymore? You know, I like home delivery, but I'd rather go down and see what I'm buying. And after a while, if I don't ever have to get to the house, I can just write notes and go on my iPad and I can just have stuff sent. And I can have somebody chew my food up for me and swallow it for me. That's next. After a while, it's no wonder I get lazy. I'm going to try this side over here. How many know we also have people that even in the body of Christ, they won't really call it a lie. It's like a white lie, but it's not true. Because they don't want to have to, whatever. Well, they won't do it for you. You know, you have to have somebody. I want to tell you this, and I want you to please get this. I love you too much to let you miss this. I believe that right now God is in this place. Now, that thrills me to know he's here as a corporate body. I know that. But if I don't have him individually living in my life, I'm in trouble. Amen. I'm not saved because my daddy was a preacher for 50 years. Amen? I'm only saved because I believe and I serve him with all my heart. He's the most important thing in my life. How many believe we need him to be our everything? Now, you have to realize when Jesus was in the tomb, he was right there in the middle of that tomb. And while he was there for three days, he was conquering in the middle of those 3 days, death, hell, in the middle of those 3 days, conquering death, hell, and the grave. You don't ever have to worry about dying if you're a child of God. Amen. The Lord showed me something. I was dreaming, like a vision the other morning, and the Lord showed me somebody came up with a gun, and they put it right at my heart, and I thought, wow, this is over. That's it. And the Lord said, if it was reality, as soon as they pull the trigger and your heart is blown open, you will begin to live eternally. Why? Because Jesus paid the price to kill death. Death has no hold on you. Oh, I've walked by the caskets of many people in this room, your family, loved ones, your friends, but I got to tell you something. I don't think very many of them were really there. I do believe a whole lot of them were already there. That's why we could shout and say they're absent from their body, but they're present with the Lord. But Terry Summers always tells me, I'm sorry for your temporary loss. How many know this loss doesn't last very long? Because as soon as I get there where they are, I'm going to shout and give praise to the Father. How many know heaven's getting sweeter all the time? Come on, I got my mama and my daddy there and a whole lot of your families and friends there. And this couple months ago, I had another brother that decided just to vacate and going over there. I got a lot to go to heaven for. And I'm not going to let messing with the world and to let the world destroy. Because why? Every day of my life, I've got the Lord in the middle of my circumstance, in the middle of my situation, and he always makes a way. Can I give you one little theory that I believe is very appropriate right now? In 2 Chronicles 20, we get to this pretty often because it's so important as teaching and instruction. The Bible said King Jehoshaphat is afraid because he's got three armies coming against Israel at one time. I want to say the word, and I want you to get this. God knows how to stop your threat. This weekend will be memorialized as the time we blessed and we gave away a precious baby back to the Father's keeping and blessed the family in a dedication. But I want you to listen. I believe this week God is beginning to stop the threats that are against your life. Nobody can do that but God. The enemy comes up with a lot of things, and some of them look real and valid. But how many know God can stop every threat? He's already started it today right here in this room. How many, he can heal a marriage before it's broken. He can heal a body before cancer destroys it. Got a telephone call, I believe it was yesterday, from Kay in the Springfield area. She went in for cancer tests, and they had already diagnosed on the last 6 months how bad she was and how desperate it was, and through all those trying to treatments and all that stuff. She called me laughing out loud, and she said, Pastor, I just had to call and tell you I don't have any kind of cancer anymore. I am totally and completely healed. Wow. Somebody said, Brother Young, you're real good at praying for folks. No, it's not that. I could lay my hand on you until my hand grows to your head. But if the Lord is in the middle of it, that's why we anoint. The oil represents the presence of God that's in the middle of the healing prayer and the sick body. How many know he is still healer? He is still savior and he is still deliverer. I want you to get into your spirit. God is bigger than your diagnosis. How many realize diagnosis doesn't have to be terminal? It doesn't have to manifest. Why? Because you've got the healer. You've got the one that loves you, the one that paid the price, the one that bled on the cross and the whipping post. Why? He did that in the middle of his pain. I believe he had me in mind and you in mind. He wasn't doing it for himself. He was saved. He was healed. But he was doing it so that I could have healing and I could have life. He's in the middle of my situation. King Jehoshaphat is fearing and he's asking Israel to come and fast and pray and seek God. Why? They're standing at the outer court of the temple and they're wanting God to come and show up in the middle of them. An unknown prophet, Jehaziel, stood up and he said, "Yo, God just gave me a word and I'm going to say it. You don't need to worry about this battle." Y'all don't even know Jehaziel and you believe him more than me. I'm going to tell you tonight, you don't have to fight the battle that you're in. Or today. If the Lord fights your battle for you, if you let him, if you allow him, what I do, believe him. Ask him. It's not a formula, just ask him. He makes a way. Am I right? He said, "Tomorrow, go down by the cliff. You won't need to fight, just stand or sit there and watch because you're going to see three armies coming against you at one time. So instead of worrying about it, I want the praise team to go. Let your singers and dancers go first." Can you imagine? You think you're tough as a soldier with a gun. What about if all you got's a tambourine and a shout? God said, "I'm putting you out there. No, go ahead and sing to me." Why would he want them to sing? He lives in the praise of his people. Which means I want to show up. And while you're singing, I'm going to say, "Now, what were you going to do? Oh, we were going to fight three armies and we couldn't win. Oh, you go ahead and sing and I'll fight the battle." Because when you're singing, I'm in the middle. Say it with me. He's in the middle of what I'm in right now. Do you sense the Lord's presence in you right now? "Oh, brother, but I'm running." You don't have to run. You don't have to go anywhere. "Oh, but I went so far, God can't find me." You can't run that far. As soon as you get there and turn around one step, he's right there. When the prodigal's on his way home, the father didn't wait till he gets to the house, knocks on the door. He met him in the middle of the return. He met him on the journey and totally and completely restored him back to his blessing and back to the favor and back to the inheritance. Why? Because now the boy has returned to the middle of the family. This is really hard this morning, but there's a change getting ready to take place today. There's situations in this room, and I'll be here next week, so don't get all excited to think, "Well, what if that don't happen? I'll have to move Brother Eddie out of the way for a minute to say it," but how many, we're going to see victory. God doesn't make mistakes. He doesn't lose battles. He doesn't fail. Can you imagine God showing on the battlefield with a little, 14, 17-year-old boy with a slingshot? Anybody ever see a slingshot? Not that kind. I'm talking about the kind you wrap around your head and throw rocks. Come on, anybody remember the old days? How we used to break our windows out of Daddy's house? Remember those? Nobody was accurate with that. Shouldn't have told that. Statute of limitations has run out so I can tell it. Why did David think he could kill the giant and wipe out an army of giants if necessary? David wouldn't do anything by himself. Because the Lord was right there in the middle of his faith, in the middle of the battlefield. I think God said, "Okay, Dave, run toward him, throw the rock, because I'm going to grab that rock and plunge it into his brain, take him out for you. You're going to honor me? You're going to believe me? I'm going to honor you." Amen. When giant fell, David cut off his head with his own sword and the whole army of giants ran. Why? Because they recognized God is in the midst. Go back to 2 Chronicles 20 and we'll close. Three armies are taking their course and they're having their battle and they're trying to bring a threat. The threat is so great that the king is worried so much because he loved his people, but he didn't know what to do. He said, "We have no force. We have no might. There's nothing we can do." God said, "You don't have to fight. Let me fight." The Bible said that while they're singing and praising God, the army of the Ammonites and the army of the Moabites and the army from Mount Seir started turning on each other with Holy Ghost confusion because God got right in the middle of all three battles and he won the war. See, God doesn't work from afar off. You have to bring him near. Everybody say, I need to bring him near. I'm ready for him to work right here. Are you ready for that? Just close your eyes for just a moment if you will. Can I pray with you? Can I bless you? It's good to see you today. Look back a moment ago and the Lord began to see, let me see a smile on your face and a confidence greater than you've ever had before. Concerning situations, I saw the concerned look turn to a smile of peace. God said, I am with you right now in the midst of you, your circumstance, your situations. I'm leading you to places you would never have known. I'm taking you someplace that I have designed for my glory. So the threats that are lodged against you right now are being broken off you and those that you love. The commanded blessing of the Lord is upon you, and the promise of the Father will not fail your falter. So I release you to the blessing and to the end of the favor that is before your footsteps. God's going to make decisions and choices with you and through you. But I want to promise you, as just a preacher, just a friend, the Lord is saying, I'm in the middle of your circumstance and situation. I'm in the middle of your gifting and your calling. What has been delayed and tarried and hindered will only be for a short time. I will take you to the other shore. Victory is already established. I'm developing, strengthening, encouraging your walk and your faith. So I bless you for where you're going, and I bless you for the consummation, the completion, and the total complete victory in Jesus' name. Go ahead and praise him for just a moment. I didn't want to say something I may never have said in 50 years of ministry, 55. The tears that you're shedding right now that are sour, you're not going to have to shed them in that way. Because God said, I am going to fight your battle for you. I'm going to reverse the decisions made against you. And you'll have a future, but it's not going to be the way the enemy has threatened that it would be. God said to tell you he's going to get great glory in the way that he works through what's going on, and what is still continual going on in your life and your future. He's with you right now. And I want to say thank you for your prayers of power and of concern. It may seem like simple prayers of utterance, but the Lord said, my ear is attentive to you. I've heard your cry, and I will not abandon you in the middle of the fire, in the middle of the storm, in the middle of the attack. But I am coming right now to give you perfect peace. I release you from the treachery and the threats. Everyone a part of your life will benefit. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Can I ask you a question? Does this make any sense to you, what I just spoke?
Yep. Yep.
I want everybody to lift your hands and say, Lord, I accept your word. I accept your promise. I accept your provision. And I thank you for a brand new beginning that is taking place in my life. Father, I'm asking, just stand if you'll, Brett, for just a moment. Father, I thank you for my brand new brother. I thank you, Father, because of the gift of salvation that you've given to him this week. I thank you, Father, because if I'd preach all these years and all I could find is one person to say, I want Jesus Christ to be the Lord of my life, it's worth all the labor, the traveling, and the hundreds of thousands of miles and all the thousands of details to get to the next location. So, Father, I command a strength to his spirit. I command the filling up completely with your Holy Ghost so that there's no room for the enemy to attack and to have lodging place with threats and worries and fears. And he's breaking off the remembrance of yesterday. Don't ever turn around and look back. You're not from the past. You're from the future. God called you and he purposed a plan for your life. And I release you for what is yet to come. And I thank you, Father, right now for a willing and obedient spirit. I thank you for a hungry heart. We as a church vow that we'll be there to have his back. We'll be there to strengthen him. We'll be there to encourage on this journey. I command the commended blessing in Jesus' name. Everybody in agreement, say the best is yet to come. I'm going to say it, the best is yet to come. Let me touch you for a moment, Bill. Father, I'm thankful right now for my friend. I'm thankful because I don't know anybody that's had to fight so many wars and battles and threats and attacks. But no matter how hard the enemy tries to knock him down, he just, like a rubber ball, he just keeps bouncing back. Father, there's some new beginnings, and Bill, it's not going to be the same old for the rest of your life. God is getting ready to seal his promise in your spirit. He's going to finish what he promised. He's going to answer the prayers, the whispered prayers, the screams. And I want to tell you in a way that, and I know you'll understand it, the Lord said, I'm in the middle of your circumstance. I'm in the middle of this situation. A series of confrontations, plans. I release you for the blessing yet to come. Thank you for it, Father. When you joined again with the men's group, my heart began to rejoice. And though I hadn't seen you for a while, the Lord revealed to my heart, he said, I have gathered a band of believers, a small army of champions to gather around and be there for him. He can vent, he can share, and he can rejoice. I speak the new beginnings to begin to unfold. Starting on this day, I claim it for the glory of God. But everybody in the house, I'm ready for the fullness, ready for the completion. Just bow your head for a moment. This is different today. That's okay. I've noticed in life that when people are going through the strong attacks, doesn't matter what your attack is. It doesn't matter what bothers you. It doesn't matter. You're different than everybody else, and their attack is different than yours. Their weakness is different than yours. We all have it. We have to make up our mind to give it back to God. But over the last several weeks, God has been speaking about a slow erosion. Death doesn't always come because of a habit or a bondage. It doesn't come in just a blast, an instant thing. Sometimes it's a slow burn. Sometimes it's a slow erosion. Little by little, our life is taken. Little by little, we don't look the same, and we don't act the same, and we don't feel the same. And after a while, people hardly recognize who we are. But the Lord said, I'm right here in the middle of your circumstance. If you'll let me, I'll turn you around and take you back to the Father's house. I believe today the most glorious thing the Lord wants from every one of us is for us just to want him, to allow him to be glorified in our life. When I saw that scenario with a bullet threatening to go through my heart, I knew that if that scenario played out, I would be instantly in the presence of the Lord. Go back a couple of months when my brother breathed his last. What gives me confidence is the fact that he knew his Redeemer lived. Otherwise, I would live in torment and worry and fear and stress if I didn't know that he had a Savior, that he served and he followed. Today, if there's anyone in this room that needs to make sure of your salvation, somebody says, well, I know about him. I want you to know him as your dearest friend. If I'm talking to you, I want you to come. We'll just take this moment. We never force anyone because you can't. We have to just give you the opportunity and allow this presence to have its right away. An old Indian preacher came to my daddy's church from Oklahoma, and he said something I've never forgotten from the time I was a little boy. He said, If I could, I'd come down the aisle and I would just drag you. I'd drag you down the aisle if I had to, but that doesn't work. I have to pray that God will make you want him. Salvation is here in the midst of this building, in the middle of the service. I feel like this is the most important thing on planet Earth that this preacher could say right now. Will you accept Jesus Christ? So what would people think? It doesn't matter what people think. It matters what God thinks. People that don't want you saved don't love you. They don't care anything about you. If they don't want to follow Christ with you, they're not your friend. They're an obstacle on your path. If you want him, he's available in the midst of where you are in life, your circumstance right now. He's right here. And he's here right now. He's here right now. Come and stand with Brother Robert. Face this way. Father, I ask you to bring salvation to Daniel. He's been fighting. I ask you, Father, to give him a cleansing of your blood. Everything that he wars with that's bigger than him right now, it's not bigger than you. I ask you to calm the storm, Father, and help him this moment to make up his mind. I'm going to decide to follow Jesus, and it's not a formula. It's not just something I've heard about, but I want to really know you and the power of salvation. Father, I've watched him week after week, struggling to make that commitment to be saved again and again. But today, I want you to seal his salvation. Let him know that you have washed him with your own blood, and I ask you to rebuke every devouring thing and every devouring spirit that has tried to rob him of joy and peace. I thank you, Father, because at this moment, we're going to do this as a family, and we're going to join with Daniel as we pray together. So pray it with me if you will. Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Wash away every spirit, every wrong, and all my past. I believe that you died as my sin sacrifice. I believe that you are my forgiveness. You're my Savior. I receive you. I believe you rose over death, hell, and the grave. I believe you conquered what has always conquered me. I receive freedom, and I will follow you all the days of my life. Now, Father, I have to be filled with your Spirit, or other spirits will come and lodge. Fill me with the power of the Holy Ghost, the very presence of your Spirit. Rule and reign where the enemy has reigned much too long, because I've confessed, it's done, and I receive the gift of eternal life right now in Jesus' name. Let's lift holy hands and give God some praise for just a moment. Magnify the name of the Lord. Magnify his name, because he is our Savior. He is our deliverer. He's our way maker. He is our provider. He is our everything. I want everybody in agreement. Say, thank God for a new name written in glory. Thank God for the gift of salvation and eternal life. Come on, say it with me out loud. Everything is going to be all right. Look over at your neighbor and tell him, I want to see you in heaven. If you're not planning it, plan now. My brother, I thought the service was about over. I'll stay here till dinner time to pray with you if you need that. How many of you realize that's why we're here? That's why we function. That's why we preach. That's why we have songs. That's why we do what we do. Because if one soul can find the gift of eternal life, it's worth everything that we've ever asked. How many know that's what it really matters? Am I right? Say it with me. One soul is worth everything. One life, one future, one new beginning. But somebody say, I believe I'm strong enough to start saying yes to God, no to the enemy, because the Lord is right here in the middle of my thinking. I wonder how many thoughts you'd think different if the Lord was in the middle of your thoughts. I wonder how many bad choices you'd made if God is right there in the middle of your thinking process. See, that's your victory. We have to remember he's present. Say, present in the midst of every situation. I believe we need to do this as a family. So lift your hand and say, I accept the healer in the middle of my physical body. I believe he's big enough. He's bigger than cancer. He's bigger than high blood pressure, diabetes. He's bigger than the effects of stroke. He's bigger than emphysema. Lord, I hit a nail on the head right there. Everybody say emphysema is leaving right now. I believe he's bigger than sickle cell, and I believe that he's bigger than brain damage. I believe he's bigger than rebellion, confusion. So, Lord, I receive my healer, because my healer's right here in the middle of me, doing a perfect work. In Jesus' name. Look at me a second. If the healer lives on the inside, how far does he have to reach to touch your organs? How far does he have to reach to touch your bloodstream? Or, come on, gout, an infection. He's right there. Very present help. Never leave you, never forsake you. Did anybody get this? If not, sit back down. I'm going to do it all over again. Get your Bible out. How many of you believe that he is in the midst of every situation, every circumstance, Come on, every diagnosis, he's in the middle of every situation, he's a present help. Am I right? You just have to want him and allow him. I want him and I allow him. Everybody say everything is going to be okay.